professionally, this trip, going to Nepal and seeing foot and mouth disease, we compared it to meeting Michael Jackson. It's just the most exciting thing for a vet to see one of the most talked about and one of the most feared exotic diseases. The training means that I've come home equipped with much better skills in the recognition and diagnosis of foot and mouth disease. We often see diseases that look a little bit like foot and mouth, so it's really important to be able to recognise that and take the right samples to exclude foot and mouth, just to prove that it's not foot and mouth, we don't have it and there's no cause for panic. And it does mean that if we ever did get it, we'd be just that bit better off. We'd be better equipped to recognise it early and to manage it if it ever did happen. It also means that I've got the skills to teach my team of vets about the disease and the private practitioners in the area as well, and also to spread the word with the farmers in the area. Surveillance is not just a vet's job, it's everybody's job, so farmers should be, you know, recognising sick or diseased livestock and letting their vet know if they see anything that's suspicious. The whole point of it is to train Australian vets and other vets from FMD-free countries in the diagnosis, recognition and management of foot and mouth disease. Foot and mouth disease is one of the most infectious and contagious viruses known to human or veterinary medicine, and it's a major trade issue, so it's obviously something that Australia wants to prevent. We don't want to get it, so it's really important to have vets that are trained in how to recognise it, how to diagnose it and what to do about it if it ever does come in. The training was really good because it was intensive 5-day course where we got to go out into the villages which had foot and mouth, and we got to look at animals in real life in the proper biosecurity equipment and do it for real rather than just for a practice run. And we got to look in the animals' mouths, look at the blisters that foot and mouth disease gives, look at the lesions and investigate the outbreaks. Oh look, we hope it never happens, but if it did, we would hope that we would have a network of really well-equipped and well-trained veterinarians and other animal health staff that would recognise it and put a lid on it really, really quickly. About 80% of people in Nepal run livestock, and that's across the country, so whether it's city or country, most people have got some sort of farm animals. And just to see the difference between that and Australia, and the advantages that we have living here of the wide open spaces, big paddocks, clean green environment, and also the biosecurity measures that we take for granted, and things like the NLIS system and traceability and ear tags and NVDs and all those sorts of things. If we did get an outbreak, it would make our job much easier to sort it out because of those things that we've already got in place. We're very lucky. So the trip was supported by the FAO and the European Commission for the Control of Foot and Mouth Disease and local land services. The biggest messages that I learnt was the importance of surveillance at every level of the livestock industry. So the farmer, the people working with the livestock, the agents, the transporters, truck drivers, plus the vet. So everybody needs to be on the lookout. Any symptoms, so you know, slobbering, lameness, animals that are depressed and off their feed. Anything that looks odd needs to be reported to a vet. So the other thing is having that really good relationship with a vet, or whether it's private or government, just somebody that you can talk to and that you can get to come and have a look at your animals. And then the other big message is swill feeding of pigs is a really dangerous thing. It's one of the greatest risk factors for foot and mouth disease, and it's illegal in Australia for a good reason. So